Thank you. Dear Chairman, ladies and gentlemen, it's my privilege to present you the 6 months midterm outcome using a new transapical device, this Cymetis Accurate TA, that just recently was approved by CE mark. So the valve itself is a porcine, a regular porcine tissue valve that is mounted within a self-expandable 19-volt stent. It is available in 3 different sizes and therefore allows to treat patients with an aortic annulus diameter from 21 up to 27. On the left, you can see the 19-volt stent. It has 2 specific features that are actually important for the implant. That is, at first, the stabilization arches here, which are meant to prevent tilting of the valve during deployment. And the other key feature is the so-called upper crown, that is the most distal part of the stent body that is partial unsheathed during step 1 of the deployment and then provides tactile feedback during the actual implantation. And just to demonstrate you the implantation technique a little bit further, at first you can obtain anatomical rotation, that is to align one of the device commissures with one of the native commissures, and it's quite helpful if you have advanced imaging techniques like the DynaCity for that. So in the next step, the upper arch or the stabilization arches as well as the upper crown is partially released, and then during the actual deployment, the valve is fully unsheathed. In the dead step, the device provides you some tactile feedback, which is which then allows for a relatively simple and almost intuitive valve positioning. On the left, you can see the final release, or the partial release has already done, and you can see that the valve slowly opens, and by gently pulling on the device, you then safely anchor it down into the aortic annulus, which led to a good result in this patient. Now, if you look at the data set, during the FIM trial, 40 patients have been treated in 5 different German sites. A typical risk profile for TAVI cohort, mean age 83, mean logistic Euroscore 21, mean SDS in 9%. So 95% of all implants were uneventful. However, 2 patients required a valve in valve. The first one due to central leak after inadequate reballooning. Basically, the pacemaker, the rapid pacing did not work in that patient. And in the other patient had initially a power valve leak due to severe calcifications, then was treated with a valve in valve, but then unfortunately led to occlusion of the right coronary ostium. So we converted him to conventional surgery, but unfortunately he did not recover from right heart failure. Other than that, 4 patients died within a 30-day time period, 3 due to respiratory reasons and 1 to unclear reason on postoperative day 19 after initial uncomplicated postoperative course. In total, 3 patients required implantation of new pacemakers due to AV block, and 2 patients suffered a stroke. Now, when analyzing the results according to the VARC definition, the device success was 92.5%, and the combined 30-day safety endpoint was reached in 25% of patients. Now, if we look at the 6 months follow-up, the Kaplan-Meier curve is demonstrating a 6-month survival of 82.5%, which actually compares well to what we have known after a CoVAF or even SAPIEN implantation, and this is quite remarkable that in a FIM trial you already match the current results. So during the 30-day follow-up until 6 months, 2 patients additionally died. One on postoperative day 82 due to cardiac arrest, and another one had respiratory problems followed by multi-organ failure, and this patient died on postoperative day 131, and these events were non-valve related. Now, if we look at the transvalvular pressure gradients, the mean gradients over the time, as expected, a significant improvement down to a mean of 12, and this gradient remained stable throughout the follow-up. If you look at the functional status, which is might be even more important than pure survival, you can see that on baseline, all patients were either in NYHA class 3 or 4, and then significantly improved, and at 6 months follow-up, 90% of patients were in class 1 or 2. Now, power valve leaks, it has been mentioned during that meeting several times, this is a real issue. Any patient that exhibits a leak more than 2 plus it has a higher risk for mortality, so we're quite pleased to see that at 6 months follow-up, 96.7% of patients demonstrated either non-trace or only mild leak on the echo follow-up, or in other words, only 1 patient had a moderate leak, and more than 2+ was not present in any of these patients. So in conclusion, we can say that the Symetis Accurate device provides a new alternative that is relatively easy to implant. The valve itself has demonstrated good hemodynamical performance, and the observed 6-month survival data compare well, as we know from the outcome from other competitor valves. In addition, we saw acceptable pacemaker rates, and I personally quite convinced that especially the low rate of relevant leaks that we have observed is really promising. So in summary, we can say that this new device is an alternative to the currently approved TAVI devices. So I would just like to once again demonstrate you the implantation technique, as this is probably of most importance for us with the new device. So after standard apical access and balloon valvuloplasty, the delivery system is sheathless inserted and then advanced under fluoro into a clearly supra-annular position, followed by anatomical rotation, so alignment on one device commissure with the native commissure, followed by the partial release, which will release the stabilization arches as well as the upper crown, still in a supra-annular position, and then you remove the safety button, and after a brief episode of rapid pacing, the valve is fully deployed, and at that time you need to apply slight tension, and the device will then give you some kind of tactile feedback that eases the implantation further. Thank you for your attention.